alaikum. This, I am your presenter this morning for Study at Islam, Imam Yahya Abdullah. We would like to begin with Dua al-Fatiha. Bismillahi r-Rahmani r-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki Yawm al-Din. إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. And we read the translation from Abdul Yusuf Ali's translation, the 2009 11th edition, with some interjections from Imam W.D. Muhammad. With Allah's name, the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer. All praise belongs to Allah, the cherisher and sustainer of all the systems of knowledge, the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer, sole master on the day of judgment. Thee alone do we worship, and thee alone do we seek for aid and assistance. Guide us along the path that is straight, the path of those to whom thou hast bestowed thy grace and thy favors, not the path of those that have earned your displeasure, nor of those who go astray. And we say something from Al-Azim, that is, God the Mighty spoke the truth. We'd like to welcome all of our listeners this morning on Study Al-Islam, and as always, we want to thank our coordinator, organizer, the future of Muhammad, for continually providing for us her consistency in bringing our learned imams and scholars, males and females, to make presentations regarding Study al-Islam, and also the Ramadan sessions that we had this past Ramadan. This morning I will be addressing the topic, building a model community, and we've already had two of our knowledgeable scholarly imams in our community. My dear friend Imam Fahim Shuaib from Oakland, California presented first, and then our young Imam, assistant Imam in the Masjid in Atlanta, Georgia, to Imam Suleiman Hamid, Rashad Abdul Rahman, both who contributed excellent presentations to this subject, building a model community. Prophet Muhammad, an orphan in hardships, we suffered many, are we to believe that struggle and hardships build character? This is part of the question that was asked. When is struggle not in accord with the Qur'an? So we have two questions here, and both of them are very interesting questions that were submitted to us to speak on by our coordinator, Sister Fisher Muhammad. So with Allah's help, I will do my part to make my contribution to this topic. So I'd like to begin by reading from chapter 93 of the Qur'an, and I will read that entire chapter. It's very short. And then I will read chapter 94, and we will move from the Qur'an to look at briefly some of Muhammad the Prophet's life as a young man. So we read from Surah Duha, the glorious morning light. This is the time of the day that is called the Duha, the glorious morning light, about 10 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. Bismillahi r-Rahman r-Rahim. With Allah's name, the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer. What Duha? By the glorious morning light. Verse 2. Wal-layli idha saja. And by the night, when it is still, verse 3, مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. Thy guardian Lord has not forsaken thee, nor is he displeased. And this is a reference to our Prophet Muhammad, prayers and peace be upon the Prophet, when he first received the revelation, there was a break in it called Fatr al-Wahi, a break in inspiration or revelation. It was about 13 months after he received the first five verses of the Qur'an, Surah 96, chapter 96, Iqra, then he was given time. There was a break in between the As-salamu alaykum to all of you also. I meant to say that early on. As-salamu alaykum. That is to our non-Muslim family, friends, relatives, and listeners. Peace be with you. I wanted to greet you this morning in Allah just placed that back on my mind. However, the Prophet, prayers and peace be upon him, he felt God had forgot about him and has left him alone because of the 13 months passing after the first 5 verses of chapter 96 of the Qur'an, verse 1 through 5. And those of you all who are Muslim, you know that chapter is titled Iqra, read, or proclaim. So the first revelation was about reading and writing, education. But it was 13 months before another revelation came, and it was chapter 68, Nun, of the pen, Qalam, of the pen. And so in between that time, the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, present peace upon the Prophet, he felt God had forsaken him. So Allah revealed to him, that God and Lord has not forsaken thee, nor has he deceived thee. Now, we have to keep this in mind too sometimes when we're going through whatever our struggles are and our circumstances, and we've made our prayers and our pleas, and we've cried out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, God, and we don't get a ready answer, a quick answer. Allah is not forsaking us, and he is not necessarily displeased with us. All we have to do is be a little patient, like our Prophet Muhammad did. He had the patience, and God gave him the revelation, continue revealing to him. Verse 4. وَلَلْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَىٰ. And our Imam Fahim Shu'aib so eloquently discussed this. And verily, the hereafter or the future will be better for you than your present circumstances. Verse 5. Also, we should keep that in mind. Whatever you're going through presently, the future. It's not just talking about the next life now. It's talking about the future. Next week, be better than this week. Next month, be better than next month. Next year should be better. We should be looking forward to the future. Verse 5. وَلَنْ سَوْفَ يُعْتِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَىٰ. And soon. Now this is God's time. It is different than our time. But Allah is telling Prophet Muhammad, and soon for him was 13 months. And soon will thy guardian Lord give thee that wherewith thou shalt be well pleased. He was pleased with the revelation, and God gave him that revelation 13 months later. So we just have to be patient sometimes, and then soon Allah says, if we believe us in God, he will give us those things that will please our heart, our souls, and our mind. Verse 6. And this goes to part of the question that Sister asked about the Prophet Muhammad as an author. Adam Yatiduka, so God is bringing to the attention now, his condition, the Prophet's condition, before the revelation, and then what was the result of it after the revelation. So Allah asked the question of the Prophet through revelation. Adam Yatiduka, Yatiman for Adam. Did he not find thee an orphan and give thee shelter and care? So God is pleasant. Were you not an orphan? And we brought you in and sheltered you. Now, all people in America, African Americans, we are orphans from our motherland and our fatherland, Africa. Most of us came from West Africa. So we were orphans. But Allah, he gave us shelter and he took care of us until we could, some of us, many of us, have gone back and reconnected with our motherland and our fatherland, our country where we came from, that our ancestors came from, that America is our country now. But where we came from, so we were orphans, found ourselves orphans in these United States of America. So much so that in the old nation of Islam, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad used to call us the lost, found nation of Islam, the tribe of Shiva. I'm speaking paraphrasing, and you all who are in the community, by the love of the nation, you know the correct language for it. The lost found tribe of Shiva, the lost found nation of Islam, the tribe of Shiva. So we were called the tribe of Shiva, and we were orphaned from our tribal ancestors here in America. So I'm making the connections from the Quran, so we read and we'll make the connection with our circumstances as much as possible. Verse 7. Well, was your doctor Dolan? and he found thee wandering, dollar. You know, when I was reading that Fatiha, what a darling, you know, we say, what a darling, the end of that Fatiha, and those who went astray, who missed the mark. So here God says, the Prophet Muhammad, and he found the Prophet wandering where? In his mind, in his thinking, he didn't know what was true religion, what was from God, and what was not. So God said, and we were the same. We were given a spirituality, we were given a religious philosophy, an ideology, a philosophy of life. And we wondered about these things because a lot of it was in contradiction to what we knew when we were in Africa. I'm making the connection with us here in America now. And he found thee wandering, and he gave thee guidance. Fahada. And we were wandering also in the nation of Islam with every deep Quran teaching and what the only Elijah Muhammad taught us, and Allah found us missing the mark in regard to what Islam was, and he guided us with Imam Wazuddin Muhammad to the right path. Fahada. And he found us wandering and gave us guidance. And she guided Muhammad the Prophet, Prayer the Feast upon him. Verse 8. Well, what your daughter, he then out of that. And he found thee in need of what? In need of spiritual guidance, in need of knowledge. The Prophet wasn't poor now. We have to keep this in mind. He wasn't a poor man. In the book that I'm going to read here, in the book of the Strategy of the Prophet Muhammad, Omar Khayyam, you read that book, and you will find in that book, he talked about how the Prophet lived in the best mansions in Mecca. And of course, most of us know that Muhammad the Prophet planned the feast upon him. His wife was very wealthy. Lady Khadija was rich, the Prophet himself, but was a businessman. So let us not think the Prophet here, this is referencing the Prophet in need in terms of material wealth. No, he had material wealth. So God said, I found you in need, but he was in need of guidance. He was in need of knowledge. He was in need of enlightenment and direction for the life of man on this earth. And God said, and made him independent. Same thing with us in America. We were in need of guidance and direction, and the light turned on for us. And Allah gave us this Quran and the life of Prophet Muhammad and these unique insights. We now wanted to be Muhammad. And have established this relevance very clearly now. And we mean no disrespect to anybody else. I'm not saying this in this way. And I'm not saying it in an arrogant way. If I am, God forgive me for that. I have no intent in that. But we are an independent, thinking Muslim community in these United States of America. By that I mean we have our own mind. We are connected with all Muslims all over the world, so I don't mean it in that way. We're part of the one Ummah of Muslims all over the globe. We are a part of the international Ummah of Muslims of every race, nationality, ethnicity, social status and class, education, wealth. We're part of that. But we have our own uniqueness in America. And Allah has made us that way. He has made us independent. So if we acclimate to everybody's ideas and philosophies and how they see things, we won't respect what God has done for us. He found us in need. Nobody came to help us. Remember, you heard me say that many times before. And remember, I'm going to say this to us. Nobody came to help us in America from all these other countries when we needed their help the most. Allah guided us to the Quran. Allah gave us Al-Islam the way He wanted to. Jihad, Farad, and the honor of Elijah Muhammad, until Imam Dari Muhammad could guide us with Allah's help to the path of Al-Islam correctly. So we are an independent thinking community in America. We're not looking for leaders from overseas. We're not looking for anybody to give us direction. We're not saying that we need a third resurrection or another resurrection. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us in these United States of America, and we thank Allah for that, and we would be disrespectful and cheating our own inheritance and blessing if we turn our back, and we're not going to do that. I'm just saying, cautioning those of us who may be thinking like that. No, Imam W. Muhammad left us with a treasure trove of knowledge, so we're not looking for anybody to come over here and put their head on our body. Okay? Verse 9. فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَتَعْهَا. And by the way, let me go back to Sa'adna, verse 8. And God will make us rich. That's what money means. That Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us, Allah has given this in the Grand Paradise, do something for yourself. And we're going to continue that. We'll continue our economic growth and progress and efforts in these United States of America. Allah will make us very, very economically, financially wealthy. Just keep working and be patient. Therefore, because we were orphans, and Old Muhammad, you were orphans, do not be harsh with the orphans. Verse 10, and do not turn away those who come to you. Look at your direction. Don't push away the petitioners. Those who come to seek knowledge and learn, don't turn away from them because we were ourselves once in those circumstances looking for guidance. In the last verse of this chapter, verse 11. وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِيثٌ. And the bounty, I hope you heard the word hadith, and the bounty and the blessings. فَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ نِعْمَةِ نَعِيمٌ نَعَامَةٌ. And the blessings, the favors of God, of thy Lord, the blessings of your Lord, proclaim a hadith, discuss and talk about how blessed we have been in these United States of America. So now I go to chapter 94 on this subject matter. Alam nashwalaka sodra, have we not expanded these apparatus? And I'm not gonna make as many comments as on this one because it'll take all the time. Verse 2. Again, addressing Prophet Muhammad, again relating it to our circumstance. وَوَضَعْنَا عَنْكَ وِزْرَكَ. And remove from thee the hardships and the burdens that you had on your back, O Muhammad. And the biggest burden Prophet Muhammad had on him, rather peace be upon him, was the ignorance and the backwardness of his people in Mecca and the surrounding areas, and he wanted answers for their problems. And I'm sure we can relate to that in these United States of America. Verse 3, الَّذِي أَنْقَضَ ظَهْرَكَ. Remove from thee thy burdens to which did gall thy back. And what's riding our back more than anything else, for us, Imam Muhammad called it the ghost of plantation life, still on our back. The back refers to the past, what's behind you. Our back is behind us. So what's there, what's in our hand, is still burdening us, and God says he can take those things off our back, take those things out of our subconscious that's weighing us down. And he has done it and continued to do it. Verse 4. وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرًا. And raise high the esteem in which thou art held. فَعِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. Verse 5. So there is, with every difficulty, there is relief. Verse 6. إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. Verily, with every difficulty, there is grief. And by the way, point out something insightful for you from Imam W. Muhammad. The word itself, usri, comes from the back of the throat, ayin. Usri means difficult, and it's difficult to say. Yusran is from the tip of the tongue. Yusran, relief, is easy to say. So the word that means ease in the Quran is also easy to say. Verse 7. Therefore, when thou art free from whatever labor and immediate task that you're doing, pick up a new challenge, still work hard. This is what God revealed to Muhammad the Prophet, so he said, I'm going to build character. Now, this is part of the question, too. Difficulty, challenges, obstacles, hardships, build character. And verse 8, وَإِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ فَارْغَىٰ. And to thy Lord, always turn thy attention. So I conclude my readings from the Quran and comments on it right quick. And I go now. We have about 10 or 15 minutes here. So the book, wonderful book, Strategies of Prophet Muhammad. So look at, within about 5 to 7 minutes, inshallah, and I'll conclude Imam Jabir Muhammad's commentary text here. I've been sharing some of it with you, but Mecca. Alright? And this is from the book Strategies of Prophet Muhammad by Omar Khayyam Sheikh. And I'm reading from page 491. Muhammad, peace be upon the Prophet, was born in orphan into the Banu Hashim clan of the Quraysh in 571 AD. I'm reading this because I can't assume that all of us are aware and familiar with the life of the Prophet. And we may have some new Muslims for the first time, so I want you to read as much as you can, encourage you to read as much as you can on the life history of the Prophet, prayers and peace upon him. Muhammad's father, Abdullah, died before he was born. Most historians believe that he died in Yathrib, which is now Medina, on his way back from a trade journey to Syria. This is by Muhammad's father. Abdullah had died at an early age of 25 and left very little wealth for his son Muhammad. 5 camels, a small number of goats, and a she-servant called Baraka to his wife. Muhammad, therefore, was born a poor orphan. An orphan enjoyed an extremely low status in Arab society. It is no coincidence that the very first directed version of the Qur'an are the following. So as for the orphan, be not thou overbearing, and as for the beggars, hold not, and as for the goodness of that Lord, discourse of it. Muhammad was born in Mecca on April 21st, 571 AD. His lineage has been recorded as follows. Muhammad bin Abdullah, Muhammad the son of Abdullah, Abdullah bin Abdul Matib, Muttalib, Abdullah the son of Abdul Muttalib, Abdul Muttalib the son of Hashim, Hashim the son of Abdul Manif, Manif the son of Qusay. As was the custom at that time, Muhammad was sent to the countryside to live with his genuine foster mother, Halima bint Abu Dwayne, and stayed with her till he was about 4 or 5 years old. When he was 6, Muhammad's mother, Amina, decided to visit the grave of her husband in Yathrib, which is now known as Medina. She set out on that journey of 500 kilometers with her orphan-born Muhammad and her servant Baraka. She stayed in Yathrib, Medina, for a month and fell ill on the return journey. They were obligated to halt at Abwa, letting the caravan go since they were slowing down the caravan. Amina, the mother of Prophet Muhammad, succumbed to her illness at Abwa after a painful few days, and the 6-year-old orphan, Muhammad, peace be upon him now, had the painful task. Imagine this. The painful task. He was only 6 of bearing his mother in this far-off land. His, and how many mothers have we buried in this far-off land away from Africa? His maid Baraka returned with Muhammad to the house of his grandfather, Abdul Muttalib in Mecca. Muhammad was well taken care of by his grandfather, Abdul Muttalib. However, he also died within 2 years. After this time, Muhammad, peace be upon him, was initiated into the household of his uncle, Abu Talib, who had 4 sons of his own. Abu Talib was not well off financially and could not provide a life of comfort for the young Muhammad. Some historians state that the young Muhammad used to earn his keep by tending a flock of sheep and herding cattle. When he was 12 years old, Muhammad began to accompany his uncle on trade journeys, so he got started into the journey. Outside Mecca, particularly to Syria, during one of these trips, he stopped at Bostra, B-O-S-T-R-E, where he met with the Nestorian monk, Bahira. Muslim historians maintain that Bahira was the first person to recognize that Muhammad would be a prophet. Muhammad, by the way, was only 12 years old at the time. Muhammad was scrupulously honest in his business dealings. He came to be known as As-Siddiq, the truthful one, and Al-Amin, the trustworthy one. His reputation for integrity brought him an offer to run the business of a rich, twice-widowed woman named Khadija bint Khuwaylid. After Muhammad had successfully managed a few trade caravans for her, she offered to marry him. He accepted her hand in marriage. He was then 25 years old, and she was 40. So I want to conclude with that brief reading on the bio that incorporated the orphanage of Muhammad the Prophet, prayer and peace be upon him, his struggle, and what helped him to build character. So I conclude this last reading, the last 5 or so minutes we have here, from Imam W.D. Muhammad. In the Quranic references that I'm going to give you, I'll give you the references, I don't have time to read them from the Quran because we are running out of time here. So I'm reading now from the book of Imam Muhammad, After Difficulty, Insights of W.D. Muhammad on Pain and Suffering. That's the name of the book, edited by Ronald Shaheed. Quote, Imam W.D. Muhammad, page 60, under the title, No Unjust Suffering. Whatever misfortune happens to you, and this goes to the question, when is struggle not in accord with the Quran? Are we to believe that struggle, hardships, be of character? When is struggle not in accord with the Quran? So we'll read both of these. Whatever misfortune happened to you is because of the things your hands have wrought. And for many of them, He, Allah, grants forgiveness. Nor can you frustrate anything or fleeing through the earth. Nor have you besides God anyone to help or protect you. That is chapter 42, verse 30. Imam Muhammad. The above verses from the Quran are addressing those who are always complaining against God. It is not addressing believers. It is addressing those who always want to blame God for their bad situation. Those who are always complaining and blaming God for their problems. They are the people who have messed up life for everybody else. In plain language, or straight to the point, they are getting punished. They are being punished for their deeds. That's what it's saying. Now I'm going to read this chapter and verse from the Quran, chapter 29, verse 10, to go along with what Imam Muhammad says here, and I just read it in English because of time. Then there are among mankind such as say, we believe in Allah. But when they suffer affliction in the cause of God, they treat man's oppression as it were the wrath of Allah. And if death comes to thee from that Lord, they are sure to say, we have always been with you. Does not Allah know best all that is in the heart of all creation? And that's chapter 29, dear believers, verse 10, to where Allah says to us, don't treat the oppression of people that it is the punishment of God. No, that is coming from mankind and not from God. Now I conclude, I'm going to go right quickly because we are out of the time here, and I want to conclude with Imam W.D. Muhammad's still in this book on page 73. God created us for struggle. Some of us think we're going to have everything on a bed of roses. No. If somebody doesn't take those roses and cut off their stems, a bed of roses can be awfully painful because they have sharp thorns. That's a lesson to us. Here is a beautiful, delicate, tender rose. But look at how it has to rise above the thorn. It is not under the thorns, but above the thorns. It has to grow and survive the passage of the thorns to crown its destiny. I have become victorious. I am victorious for hard-heartedness, cruelty, and defiance. You see, the rose invites the lover, while the thorns defy the lover, saying, get back, stay back. However, the rose has ascended above that, and it crowns itself saying, I'm better than you. I'm higher than you. I deserve to be above you, thorns. I am beauty, and I invite the love. So life is a challenge, as I conclude, and we have to face the challenge. I'm putting them on it. That means accepting that life is a challenge, and then deal with it, knowing that we have already been equipped by our very human makeup to surmount it, to beat it, to get it out of our way, if it is in the way of us going where God wants us to go. Nothing can stay in our way if we are determined to go where God wants us to go. We are creatures of struggle. God says to us in Scripture, He has created us to struggle. struggle for struggle, and struggle means work. That's chapter 90, verse 4. God said if you work, your work will bring you to a state of ease. If you want comfort, relief from hardship, then work hard. This is the principle that we need. This is the disposition we need towards challenges, difficulties, opposition, pain, and suffering from obstacles in our way. We need a spirit to rise up and go out singing and dancing to meet the challenge. Don't go out looking sad like you defeated already. Go like some of those spiders in the boxing ring. They come in the ring and they make their opponent wonder. Is this guy Hansen coming here to fight me? That's the way we should be going into the world of work. When you get there and the man rings the bell to start the work, you should go at it as seriously as those spiders go at it. God has laid us for production. Those who victimize themselves, who think they are victims, are going to be victims in life permanently. They aren't going to ever be invited to share in the wealth and resources of the world. That kind of person cannot become productive. The person that will become productive is the person who rises up to the challenges and says, hey, I'm not going to accept that this is in my way. I know I'm entitled to this honor, to this dignity, to this self-respect, and it's bigger than just self-respect. It is community respect. My people are entitled to community respect. I'm not going to be satisfied with my community being neglected like this. I'm going to rise up and get this problem solved. Be determined to do it, and you will see God with you, and miracles will begin to happen. End quote, Imam W.B. Muhammad. And I want to thank all of you all for joining us this morning on Study Al-Islam. And I want to thank our dear sister and my friend, Sister Muhammad, for bringing up these powerful and wonderful programs. And if you want to re-listen to the program or share it with anyone, you can go to studyalislam.com website. Listen to the lecture again. It will be posted under the presentations, Study Al-Islam. So we say, As-salamu alaykum. That is, may Allah's peace be upon all of you. And thank you all for joining us this morning. And it has been my honor to be your presenter, Imam Yahya Abdullah, coming to you from the beautiful sunshine state of Florida, the lovely city of Jacksonville. As-salamu alaykum and have a wonderful day.